Good morning everyone, I am Dr. Yogesh. Today I am presenting a lecture on diagnostic microbiology. From the time of Pasteur as well as Koch, it was clearly established that microbes are the cause of numerous diseases and infections. With the advancement of microbiology, it has become possible to relate the disease to a particular microbes, and proper identification of the particular microorganism can lead to specific treatment plans. So before going to the topic, first we need to understand what is the purpose of this diagnostic microbiology, what are the application, and what are its utility in daily life. So what is basically this diagnostic microbiology is? So as the name indicates, it is the combination of word diagnostic as well as microbiology. So most of the infections are caused by one or other microorganism, whether it is a bacteria, fungi or virus or protozoa. So it is the application of knowledge of microbiology in identification of the particular pathogen, that is diagnosis. Diagnostic microbiology sometimes also referred as clinical microbiology. It comes into the picture during search for the causal agent of the disease. The main purpose of diagnostic microbiology is to isolate and identify a particular organism that is responsible for the disease. So, where it is applied in daily life? When a person goes to the hospital, when the case is a suspected infection, then the doctor prescribes several tests to identify the causal agent. Then once the causal agent is identified, then they also check for the antimicrobial therapy, and they will check to which antimicrobial compound the pathogen is susceptible. Hence they can go for a treatment plan. So if the doctor or healthcare provider suspects the infection as the possible cause of disease, then further, they need supporting evidence as well as clear-cut diagnosis is very much essential for the treatment. Here, the diagnostic microbiology comes into picture and plays a vital role in identification of the particular microorganism. So, this diagnostic microbiology is not only responsible for isolation as well as identification of the pathogen, but also it determines the susceptibility of the pathogen to antimicrobial agent, and these may assist in treatment of the disease. So, when the clinical microbiologist detects or identifies the microorganism as a causal agent of the particular disease, in order to relate the microbes to the disease, the sample has to be collected from the sick host. Sometimes the direct observation is necessary and it is possible also. However, many cases so apart from the direct observation, clinical microbiology or diagnostic microbiology also includes methods like growth dependent techniques, molecular techniques or immunoassays as well. So in clinical laboratories, these are the common steps to grow and isolate and identify a particular pathogen after around 48 hours of the sampling. And sometimes these methods are not sufficient. So indirect methods or rapid methods are also used in clinical laboratories, such as immunological based methods or molecular techniques, which can identify a particular microorganism when it is difficult for the growth of the organism as well. So, when these diagnostic tests are useful, these tests are useful only when the test is specific as well as it is sensitive. Now, what's the meaning of the term specificity? So, it is the ability of the test to recognize a single pathogen. When we say optimal specificity, or optimal specificity means a specific pathogen or single pathogen can be identified and it should not identify any other pathogen. When it is highly specific or high specificity, then most of the cases false positive results will be eliminated. Hence, high specificity tests are very much essential to prevent false positive result. For instance, in case of detection of Neisseria gonorrhoeae, which causes the gonorrhea, which is a sexually transmitted disease, the specific gram staining is general procedure for the urethral exudates. In men, about 99% as well as in women, 95% of the tests are specific and false positive results are very, very rare. Coming to the sensitivity. Sensitivity means if the test is very sensitive, then it can detect lowest number of pathogen or lowest amount of the product which is produced by the pathogen can be detected. So, whenever the test is devised or designed, it is very much essential for the test to have specificity as well as sensitivity. So, if the test is very much sensitive or highest level of sensitivity, then it should be capable of identifying single organism or single molecule. When the test is highly sensitive, it prevents false negative results. So, in case of diagnostic microbiology, it can be divided broadly into three types based on the method which is employed in the test. One is the growth dependent on diagnostic methods. The second one is immunology or unrelated diagnostic methods, which mainly involves antibody and antigen reaction, and several methods which are devised based on this antigen-antibody reaction. And with the advancement of molecular techniques, many nucleic acid-based diagnostic techniques also are employed in diagnostic. It may be nucleic acid hybridization, or it may be nucleic acid amplification such as PCR, RT-PCR and other things. So, in this lecture, we will be discussing in detail about growth-dependent diagnostic methods, which involves isolation of the pathogen from clinical specimen, and growth-dependent identification methods, as well as once the organism is identified, then antimicrobial drug susceptibility tests. So, in case of growth-dependent diagnostic methods, the first step and important step is the collection of the specimen. Once the sample is collected, then it proceeds with the isolation as well as growth of the pathogen and other tests. So, positive identification of the pathogen is followed by antimicrobial susceptibility testing, which can devise a specific treatment for the particular disease. So, in case of isolation of pathogen from clinical specimen, the sample can be any fluid or tissue samples, and it can be, the sample can be processed either for the microbiological analysis or immunological studies or microbiology analysis. So, if the suspected case is a disease, the suspected disease is a cause of infection. So, In case of laboratories, suppose a patient is suspected to have infectious disease, then that assays can proceed with the antibody assays where blood samples will be collected and it can be checked for the antibodies using agglutination assay or radioimmunoassay or ELISA antibody immunoassays and many more assays. And it can detect antibodies against suspected pathogen. In the other way, there are other assays which can be employed where the samples can be blood, feces, urine or tissue biopsy or mucosal swabs. It can either proceed with the growth dependent microbiology or molecular biology or immunology, such as antigen assays or molecular assays as we discussed before. So, in case of growth dependent microbiology, that what we are discussing in this lecture, it can proceed with enrichment techniques where it can use selective or enriched or differential media for the growth of microorganism, identification of the microorganism. Then it proceeds with the isolation, that is pure culture. Then further identification, it may use growth dependent or immunological or molecular identification. So in this lecture, we are focusing on this aspect. So when we say sample, the sample may include either it can be a blood or it can be urine or it can be feces or sputum, cerebrospinal fluid or pus from the wound. So that depends on the type of infection. Sometimes swabs may also be used to obtain samples from suspected area, such as it can be skin or nails or throat. Then further, the swab can be used to inoculate the surface of agar plate or tube liquid. Sometimes the biopsy sample or the tissue sample may also be used for the culture of the suspected pathogen. So, this diagram indicates a method of obtaining a specimen from upper respiratory tract. Maybe in today's this COVID-19 pandemic, maybe you have seen in television or maybe you have seen directly like how people are collecting, how the healthcare workers are collecting the samples from the suspected patients. So this picture indicates to how these throat swabs are collected. This is the swab and the sample will be collected from here. And the second one is nasopharyngeal swab. It is passed through nose and here it's the sample gets collected. The sample may be a mucus which contains the suspected pathogen. And the second one, the third one is the nose cavity. The nose cavity where mucus will be secreted or any other samples can be collected from nose. So these are the way to collect swab from upper respiratory tract. So if the clinically relevant pathogenic microorganism that need to be isolated and identified, first specimen should be obtained and it should be handled in such a way that pathogen should survive. So if the method is not proper where you lost the viability of the pathogen, then it is difficult for the isolation as well as identification of the organism. The first step is, the first step here is the specimen collection and it has to be collected from the actual site of infection. Then once the sample is collected, it has to be taken aseptically to avoid contaminations with irrelevant organisms. So because once the sample is collected, there is chance of getting contamination is very high. So it has to be collected aseptically and it has to be protected so that contamination don't happen from the irrelevant microorganisms. And the next step is the amount of sample. So here the sample size must be enough to ensure that the inoculum is having sufficient number of microorganism, and also it is sufficient for the growth of the microorganism. So sample size also is an important criteria during collection of the sample. Then finally, one should have some idea regarding metabolic requirement of the organism, because sometimes the sample has to be maintained and stored as well as transported. So once the metabolic requirements are known, then it is easy for designing a media or the transportation mode so that the pathogenic microorganism survives. For example, suppose the sample is obtained from anoxic site where oxygen concentration is very, very less, then it has to be stored and transported under anoxic condition, because exposing to aerobic condition may lead to death of the or viability of the organism may be reduced. Hence, it is very much essential to transport the sample in anoxic condition. And also it should be noted that samples stored or transported should be, the time frame should be minimum, and it has to be processed as soon as possible. Because when the sample is left for longer time, then the number of viable cells or the pathogenic organism may reduce its capacity to grow in the laboratory. Hence, it should be taken care that the transportation time as well as processing time should be very, very less. Direct observation is one of the important method where the suspected pathogen is directly observed under the microscope. For instance, suppose a person is suspected to have tuberculosis and a healthcare provider or the doctor suspects that this is the case of tuberculosis, the suspected case of tuberculosis, then they will ask the person to get screened for the sputum sample. And the sputum sample is stained with acid fast staining. And if the acid fast positive results comes, then it can be a suspected case of tuberculosis. So once it is suspected to be tuberculosis, then further analysis like molecular techniques like PCR can be employed for the further clear identification of the infection. So in this picture you can see here, it's the acid fast staining method where sputum sample is smeared and acid fast staining is performed. Red cells indicates acid fast bacteria, whereas blue cells are non-acid fast bacteria. So this is the preliminary test, which is a direct observation of the specimen. The specimen here is the sputum sample. Hence, it gives the prediction of suspected case of tuberculosis. Next, apart from this direct observation, many growth media and culture techniques are employed in case of this diagnostic microbiology. And in case of enrichment culture, here it uses a selected culture media and as well as conditions for the incubation to isolate a particular microorganism from the sample, and is a very much important technique in clinical laboratory. And most of the clinically important microorganisms are grown and isolated and identified using specialized growth media, which reduces the burden on confusion with respect to unwanted microorganism. So clinical samples are generally first grown on general purpose media such as blood agar. The blood agar is generally used to analyze hemolytic ability of the microorganism. This blood agar generally supports the growth of most of the aerobic as well as facultative aerobic microorganisms. Microorganisms are also isolated from media and often subcultured in specialized media like enriched media containing a specific growth factors that can enhance the growth of fastidious pathogens such as Neisseria gonorrhea. They require special requirement for the growth. And many other cases, selective media are also used, which allows some organism to grow while it inhibits other organism. That's why it is called as selective media, because it may contain many inhibitory agents. And finally, the differential media. The differential media, as it indicates, the name itself indicates, it differentiates. That's why the media is called as differential media. And these are the specialized media which allows identification based on their growth, color, appearance on the medium. Blood culture method, it involves the sampling of blood and blood will be checked for the presence of pathogen. Bacteremia is the condition where the microorganism is present in the blood. In humans, the blood is generally sterile. So, the presence of bacteria in blood is a condition of bacteremia, where it is a clear-cut case of infection. And other term is septicemia or sepsis, where blood infection by a virulent pathogen enters the blood and it can travel to various parts of the body and tissues and initiate new infection. So, when you collect a sample of blood, it need to be detected for growth of bacteria, and many automated systems are being employed in many hospitals. It is also followed by microscopic examination and subculturing. Even though there are methods of immunology as well as molecular biology, the culture methods are still being employed for the detection of many pathogens. And most common pathogens found in blood generally includes gram-positive cephalococci and enterococci species, and gram-negative bacteria such as Pseudomonas aeruginosa, and some enteric bacteria such as Enterobacter species. E. coli and Klebsiella are another common gram-negative bacteria which are generally found in blood infections. And many cases, fungi is also found to be an infectious agent present in the blood. The condition is called as fungemia. Similar to bacteremia, it is called as fungemia. Similar to blood, urine culture also performed. Sometimes urine sample collected is directly observed for the presence of microorganism with the staining techniques, or the urine also is subjected for the culture for detection of the particular pathogen. Generally, the gram stain may be done or performed on urine sample which is exhibiting bacteriuria. Bacteriuria is a condition where bacteria is present in the urine. And identify will be performed based on the morphology of the pathogen present in the urinary tract. Generally, these tests are performed for the detection of gram-negative cocci such as Neisseria, as well as gram-positive cocci such as Enterococci. Apart from this gram staining, other direct staining methods are also useful for the detection of bacteria in other body fluids such as sputum, wound exudates, sometimes like cerebrospinal fluid. When differential media are employed, so differential media generally incorporates a differentiating component in the media. So with respect to the growth, with the ability of the microorganism to grow, or presence or absence of enzymes which can catabolize a specific substrate, on this principle, this differential media works. So the microorganism can have the ability to ferment a particular sugar, or it can change the pH of the indicator with the acidification, or it can produce gas, or it can produce hydrogen sulfide, which can react further with ferrous sulfate to make a black color precipitate. And if it can change the color of the media with respect to production of many acids and many more things. So these are the things which are employed in differentiating the microorganism based on their ability to grow as well as utilize particular carbohydrate or presence or absence of enzymes. Once these biochemical reaction patterns are observed, so the results of this or the diagnostic results of these reactions are stored in the computer database, and the tests are matched in such a way that a particular unknown organism and its metabolic pattern can be used for the identification of the organism. Suppose some four different bacteria are there, you have identified, and you have put all this data like glucose utilization positive, gas production positive, or hydrogen sulfide production positive or negative. So when you provide this data in computer, it will compare the data with respect to the database, then it can give a suspected match to the particular pathogen. Hence, it can be helpful in identification of the particular microorganism. This picture indicates use of differential media, where you can see the acid production, which is indicated by color change. And you can also see the production of gas. So in this picture, from left to right, when you see, this is the production of acid. This is the production of acid as well as gas. The third one is a negative result, which is not producing either acid or gas. The fourth one is the uninoculated tube. So in this picture, it indicates when the organism is inoculated, where it's producing acid or is also producing gas. So this data is very much essential in comparison. The second one and most commonly used one of the differential media is triple sugar iron agar. As the name indicates, it contains three sugars. One is glucose, then lactose and sucrose, where the glucose is present in small amount, whereas lactose as well as sucrose is present in large amount. And this media is also able to detect production of gas as well as production of hydrogen sulfide. So when the organism is able to ferment only glucose, then it leads to formation of acid only in the butt region. Whereas when it can utilize lactose and sucrose and ferment, it can produce acid. It produces the acid throughout the slant, not only butt region, but throughout the slant. When gas formation is detected, it can break the agar bud like this. And if the organism is having the ability to produce hydrogen sulfide, then it reacts with ferrous sulfide and it gives rise to black color precipitate. You can see the black coloration of the butt region as well as the whole media here. So in this picture, the left one is the utilization of glucose or the fermentation of glucose only. The second one is no reaction. The third one is the ability of the organism to produce hydrogen sulfide. Hence, it is blackening of the media is seen. The fourth one is fermentation of glucose as well as sucrose present in the media. The whole tube is yellow color due to acid production. This picture indicates citrate utilization test, where the organism can utilize citrate and the change in pH will lead to change in color of the indicator present. So blue coloration is the positive result for the citrate utilization. And the second one is the negative and third one is the uninoculated. So when the organism don't have the ability to utilize citrate, then the media remains green. When the organism is having the ability to utilize citrate, then it is blue in color. Based on these things, many miniature media kits have been commercially produced, which contains different sugars. And when the suspected organism is inoculated and it produces different coloration reaction on incubation, which directly indicates number of positive as well as negative results for the utilization as well as the metabolism of the microorganism. Indirectly, it relates to the identification of the particular microorganism. So this is a commercial media kit where it contains small amount of media, and we need to inoculate the particular microorganism young culture so that it can produce different coloration reactions. The next one is the similar one, a miniature test kit which contains different sugars. Here you can see different sugars and different chemicals. Urea is there, acetylene is there, xylose, glucose, like the several sugars are there. When organism is inoculated and incubated, it produces coloring reaction based on its metabolism. So once we get the data of the metabolism or the chemical reaction of the particular microorganism, we compare this data with the list provided in the kit, and we'll note down which is positive, which is negative result for the test organism, and the database will compare the suspected organism to be matching with the given database. It may match with the E. coli, or it may match with Neisseria gonorrhoeae, or it may match with Staphylococcus aureus, like that. Based on this, we can detect the particular microorganism. So once the microorganism is detected, it is very much essential to understand its susceptibility for the antimicrobial therapy. So in general medical practice, once the wound is, suppose a person is suffering from wound infection, a sample will be collected, then the dominant microorganism will be isolated, the sample will be streaked, and the dominant microorganism will be collected. Then it is subjected to broth culture. Once the culture is grown, a uniform lawn of the bacteria is prepared. Then, once it is prepared, several antibiotic discs are placed, which contains different antibiotics, and it will be compared that to which antibiotic the particular microorganism is susceptible. So here you can see these are the discs which contains different antibiotics, and if the bacteria is susceptible, the growth is inhibited. In this picture, this antibiotic disc, the disc which contains antibiotic, is not at all killing the pathogen. Whereas this antibiotic, by visual observation, we can make out that it is more effective compared to other antibiotics. So if the particular person is suffering from a particular infection, then this antibiotic may be prescribed by the doctor for the treatment of the person. The diameter is measured for the clear zone. Hence, this antibiotic can be used. And many cases, antibiotics also can be checked for how much antibiotic we have to use. That is, we use a method where different concentration of antibiotics are used in microtiter plate, and the organism is inoculated. At particular concentration which kills that microorganism can be considered as an effective concentration of the antibiotic to kill particular load of microorganism. This picture indicates is a form which represents micro budget acquisition, where you can see the dynamic microbiology plays a vital role. You can see here, this is the gram strength report. Here it detects whether the microorganism is gram positive or negative, other things. Then it also indicates the growth of the particular microorganism. Then here you can see the source of specimen. The specimen may be blood, cerebrospinal fluid, throat samples, sputum and urine, so and so. Then test required also is indicated here. Routine culture, non-routine culture. Routine culture includes many gram strain, anaerobic culture, aerobic culture, some many other things. Then screening culture is also a method here. Then whether the bacteria is acid fast or not. So many assays. So this is the form which indicates the diagnostic microbiology where different tests are performed in order to identify a particular pathogen. In this way, we generally use this diagnostic microbiology for the identification of particular pathogens, and it is also helpful in treatment of the particular pathogen. These are the references that I have used for this class. Thank you.